Hello. Welcome to Living Well Naturally. I'm Dr. Anna Saylor, a KST chiropractor and owner of Van Every Family Chiropractic Center, located in Royal Oak, Michigan. I'm also a minivan driving mom, a wife, a daughter, a sister, a friend, an animal lover, and a green thumb. My mission is to share and explore the ins and outs of a healthy lifestyle to help you be the best you possible. My patients, men, women, children, from 3 hours old to 103 years young, all have one thing in common. They want to feel better. Just as I do for my patients in my office, my goal on this show is to provide you with the information, the insight, experience, and motivation that will allow you to feel better and put you on the path to living well naturally. Today, my guests and I will be discussing raising healthy kids naturally. It goes beyond whether or not their food is organic or how well their bike helmets fit. We are surrounded by items and products that seem absolutely harmless. Too late, we find out that there may have been lead in the paint or harmful chemicals in the plastic. We even find ourselves questioning the water we're drinking. How do we as parents and educators make people aware of everyday things that could be harmful to our families? What are some of the major causes for concern, and what can we do to protect our children? Joining me today are Joanne Shango and Dr. Marissa Heisel. Joanne, tell me a little bit about yourself.
Well, I'm a mother of three children. I strive to raise my children naturally and holistically as possible. I'm also a Montessorian. I opened the Montessori School Rochester 2.5 years ago because I wanted to promote a natural education program for my children. I couldn't find one that really suited what I believed fully without compromise. So we opened the school for my children and for all the children in the Metro Detroit area to have that opportunity to go to school and educate their children in a very natural way that supports natural parents.
Awesome. And one of my children go there too. So my daughter Bryden goes there.
And she is wonderful.
And Dr. Heisel, tell me a little bit about you.
I am a holistic integrative chiropractor. I'm based in Hanover, Ontario in Canada. And I'm also, I was trained as a midwife as well. And I was a doula for a number of years. So my real focus is on women and children's health. I see patients of every age group just like you do, but my love is really helping women to be the healthiest physically and emotionally that they can be in order to be able to have the patience and the love and the excitement for their children to help them grow strong as well.
Wonderful. Well, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Okay. So today we're raising healthy children naturally. Let's first talk about some of the issues that we're seeing. We were talking earlier about toxins in the environment. Want to share some ideas with that?
I've got a lot of ideas about that.
I know you do.
I think that we've created a society where we've tried to inoculate our children against everything. And in the interim, what we've really managed to create is a society that's really filled with chemicals and with toxins. And we've inundated our children with these things, and then we wonder why, at a time where we spend more money on healthcare than at any time in history in North America, we have children who are sicker with chronic illnesses than they've ever been before. And not only with chronic illnesses, but with illnesses that we used to only see in middle age and upwards. And so we're really seeing the effects of what we're feeding our children, the air that they're breathing, the water that they're drinking, and all of the hormone modulators. We see girls with early and earlier puberty. We see more infertility, more cancers, more type 2 diabetes in children that should absolutely not be happening. And so a big part of my focus is really on what are we eating, what are we using to clean, what are we putting on our children, and what's generally in our environment. I often say that we can't affect the outside of our, you know, the outside air or anything outside of our house or our workplaces. But certainly if we own our own businesses and in our own homes, we can really affect a lot of that.
Wonderful.
Yeah. It's funny, as a mom, you know, I try to do the same thing, and people always say, you know, oh, it's so great, you know, you feed your children organic food and all of this stuff. But also if they happen to eat the, you know, eat the broccoli that fell on the floor and put it in their mouth before I have a chance to stop them, it's like, oh my gosh. And I say, it builds antibodies. It builds antibodies. It's okay. Because we can't protect them from everything. What we can do is build their bodies to be really, really strong. And that's a really wonderful thing. And it's the same thing in our schools. We hardly have any plastic at our school. You know, parents are so great and supportive and want to be part of the program. It's like, can I bring you this toy? And I'm like, is it wood or plastic? And plastic. I'm like, no, thank you. You know, we really appreciate it. But we really try to maintain the environment in a very natural way, using natural elements from things like seeds, where they might be sorting and counting, to all wood, you know, from the furniture and the chairs, to the trays that they do their work on, the materials themselves. So to support exactly that kind of real natural.
Wonderful. What kind of solutions do you bring like, I know both of us are chiropractors, but what else could you do to raise your children healthy and naturally?
I do a number of things. You know, with my own kids, I've got two children and three stepchildren. In our house, we don't use any chemical cleaners. In fact, for a number of years, I used natural cleaners, and at this point, I use microfiber and water, or vinegar, or lemon essential oil. Okay. So that I really limit anything that's left on surfaces. And they clean beautifully. Tests have shown that they're more antimicrobial than all of the chemical cleaners. I always ask every year, by the second week of school, half of every class and all of the staff are sick. Mm-hmm. And so if the chemical cleaners that we're using work, why are our kids sick all year long?
Right.
Yeah. We do actually very similar at the school. We always have essential oils running in each of the classrooms. We clean with the essential oils where we're allowed to. Anywhere that we're not, we try to find the most safe, healthy cleaners that we can use that still meets, you know, state standards. But we use the essential oil cleaners, vinegar, things like that, as much as we can as well.
One of my teacher's gifts every year for every new teacher is we do essential oils, we do a diffuser for them. And so I want to protect my children and, you know, healthier environment too for all my kids.
Yeah, it really has made a difference too. The amount of illnesses that happen in our school is decreased a lot. We switched over to this about a year and a half ago. So the first 6 months of the school were we were using standard cleaners that was recommended by the state licensing, and then we started to switch over, and it's been drastically different. We don't see the long carryover. It's really amazing. Only one or two children might get sick versus, you know, within a week you're missing half of your class. All of that's really been severely reduced in a wonderful way, which is awesome. Fabulous for our families.
By wonderful, healthy, natural cleaning.
Yeah.
So one of the things that we do as chiropractors too is, obviously my belief is if the nervous system is functioning properly, they don't get as sick. And I can say both my children, I have a 7-year-old and a 3-year-old, have never been in antibiotics. They don't ever get sick. And one of the techniques we use is a very different type of technique called KST. And we adjust a lot of children in our practice. So, and I know you do as well, Dr. Heisel. So tell me a little bit how you think chiropractic can help kids.
Very much what you said as well. You know, I find that oftentimes, even from birth on, even in the most natural of births, if a child hasn't been in a particularly good position in utero for you know, 7, 8, 9 months, if a birth is maybe a little more medical than it needed to be, if there's more force that's applied to a child's head or neck as they're being born, any number of things, I find that those kids, right from early on, start to show signs of difficulty with feeding, possibly with positioning as they're trying to latch if they're breastfeeding, or real digestive difficulty. And it can be really simple with a newborn child to just very, very gently do a really small adjustment so that their nervous system is running as efficiently as possible in order to allow that child to have the best start in life as they possibly can.
Wonderful. And I know a lot of people they hear chiropractic and they think chiropractic for children, why would you take your child to the chiropractor? Or how they think it's a little more dramatic than it is. And as you just saw from the video, we practice KST, which is a very, very gentle technique.
Yes.
It uses the handheld tool. And I know Joanne brings her lovely children to our office.
I do, and I didn't do chiropractic with my younger children, even though I've always been a patient of chiropractic. With my two older children, I didn't bring them because it made my husband nervous. And then when I met you, I knew, you know, I explained it to him. I said, she says it's very non-invasive, very gentle. And I took my baby when he used to have ear infections, you know, Sevi, and it was amazing. He'd almost go into a trance. He would see Dr. Saylor, and he would just be like, oh, it's so great. And it made a world of difference. And then my husband felt really comfortable. He's like, okay, we can adjust all the children. And the difference in their health, but also their emotional well-being, it makes a huge difference. I run to you when Sevi's having, you know, a few rough days. And it's a world of difference. He sleeps better. He talks better. He's happier.
Wonderful. Let's talk a little bit more about the stress in the environment. How can we, you know, help decrease stress with our family and our children?
Well, in Montessori, we always say, you know, follow the child. It's the biggest catchphrase in Montessori that you can have. What that really means is if you can educate and encourage and raise your children through what their interests are, the leads that they're giving you, then what you end up finding is they're happier, they're learning more. Montessori children are not smarter, they just know how to learn better because we're not forcing anything on them. We're looking at them and we're saying, you know, what are they interested in? The teacher's taking her cues from them. And when you take the cues from your children, then you're not battling them. And they're not as frustrated. And if they're not as frustrated, then they're more open to the world that you're offering them, the world that they're actually trying to naturally explore. That's their goal. Yes. And by following their interests is the biggest difference.
Okay. Dr. Heisel?
I find a couple of things. One, I think, is the health of the parents, particularly the health of the mother. Children pick up so much of what we're feeling. And so if as a mother we're really struggling, potentially with postpartum or with baby blues or even just with the stresses of being a working parent or even a stay-at-home mom who's got all of the responsibilities of all of the child care and the house, the cooking, the cleaning, the grocery shopping, the errands, and everything else, women get really stressed. And we throw ourselves so wholeheartedly into parenting that sometimes we forget that we're human beings and that we're adults. Mm-hmm. Who need our own interests, some creative space, some time to ourselves. And children pick that up. The more uptight, potentially, that a parent might be, the more that the child struggles. But I also think it's what we feed our kids. You know, kids who have a diet that's high in sugar, high in dairy, high in gluten, high in red meat. You know, so many kids are so strung out on sugar these days that it's really concerning. And so I think the more naturally that we can feed our kids, you know, my kids don't like vegetables argument, how early did you start? Or did you start them with, you know, chocolate cake before they were the age of one? And
wonderful.
I think we need to look at that.
Yeah, we do. So we're going to need to take a quick break, so we'll be right back after this message.
Hey, everybody. Heart disease affects one in every three women in America, but you can fight back. There's no time to lose. Mothers, sisters, daughters, families, and friends, it's time to shout louder, stand stronger, and demand change. Let's go!
To the Batmobile. Dang it.
To the invisible jet.
Dang it.
Together, we can put an end to heart disease. It's time to go red for women. I could use your help. Yeah! Learn more from the American Heart Association at www.goredforwomen.org.
Heart, what's going on?
I'm leaving.
Why? What did I do?
Not enough. The pressure is too much. I quit.
I get it. I can do better. Just please, don't leave.
Don't let your heart quit on you. Get your uncontrolled high blood pressure to a healthy range before it's too late.
We're back with my guest, Joanne Shango, the Montessori School of Rochester, and Dr. Marissa Heisel, a KST chiropractor, midwife, and essential oil specialist. We've been talking about raising healthy children naturally. We just left off about talking about food, so let's talk a little bit more about that.
What I was going to say to that point, I try to feed my children very naturally, and my son has what's called SPD, it's sensory processing disorder, and he's been doing amazing. And then a few weeks ago, he started really melting down, and so I brought him to get adjusted, and as you adjusted him, you had mentioned, you said, there's something, you know, is he consuming something, maybe something pink? And I was like, I don't know. And it hit me. It was the Danimals that my husband had bought, which we'd never had in our house before. Never. And they were having it. It was a quick, easy fix to take him to breakfast. I mean, I cook organically. I cook everything that they eat primarily. And that was it. We took that out of his diet, and within 2 days, he was completely different. Mm-hmm. It was astounding. And I'd always known as a parent, but sometimes, you know, we take shortcuts. You know, we're human, as you said. But it's amazing when you see the difference in your children, you know, to look at something so simple, the difference that it made.
And it's funny, I think when you feed your children naturally and then they get into something, mm-hmm. you know, my son's in grade 7 now in a high school, the middle school's in the high school, and so he'll take a few dollars in his pocket and go get himself something that he shouldn't necessarily be drinking, and he'll come home and he'll just say to me, I shouldn't have had that. So it's great that I've got a child who knows what he shouldn't have, but you really see it more with kids who eat a certain way. Yeah. Kids who always eat highly processed, highly sugared foods, parents don't even realize that that's a big part of what's causing them to be sick, not causing them to be at their healthiest or their immune function to work as well as it possibly should be, because it's just so easy. You know, when I have parents who come in and I hear their kids saying as they're leaving, and now we're going to a fast food restaurant for a treat, you know, my hair curls.
It actually happens at the school sometimes, you know, during that first week of adjusting, and, you know, parents, you know, they're trying to, like, you know, make their kids more comfortable. And after school, I'll take you to go get ice cream. And I shudder and I say, you know, I think that you should just remind them that it's a great place to be and just let them be comfortable with that. Because, yeah, you're trying to make them comfortable. You're bribing them. But it's just so unnecessary. Just, you know, remind them, you know, that you trust them, and keep giving them the healthy food options. Like my son, I told him that animals didn't make his body feel good. He never asked for them again. And this is a kid with sensory processing disorder. Sometimes they want things and they'll melt down. And he was like, you know, Mom, I feel better. And
no, I think you told him Dr. Saylor said that.
I did say Dr. Saylor said.
I did.
I actually absolutely did. And he was fine with it, you know, because Dr. Saylor knows everything. That's really how he feels. She's amazing. But yeah, he didn't complain about it. And they've been sitting in our drawer because I had nothing to do with them. And so they've been sitting in the drawer, and not one of my children after that went to them. They didn't care. They said, can we have Greek yogurt? And they said, yeah, yes, you can have organic Greek yogurt.
My funniest story, my four-year-old came home from my mother-in-law's house, and she's like, did you know they have food at McDonald's? And I was like, excuse me? And she's like, they have food at McDonald's. And I was like, first of all, no, they don't have food at McDonald's. She thought it was a coffee house, because occasionally we'd stop on the road and get a coffee, so she had no idea there was food there. And my mother-in-law said, okay, she had water, she had apples, but she did have a cheeseburger, because we always take the grandchildren there. Mm-hmm. And all the way home, she was doubled over saying how bad her stomach hurt. Mm-hmm. And I was like, honey, do you know what that is? And this is, you know, she's four at the time. I said, that is McDonald's. It is not good food for you. It doesn't make you feel good. And she knows now, like, it does not make her feel good.
Yeah.
So.
And, you know, one of the things that we do at the school is we really encourage healthy eating and expanding a child's palate, you know, from the youngest age. You know, in our two-year-old classroom, you'll see the teacher spend 15 minutes, which is a long time for children to sit, but she'll cut open a green pepper, and she'll smell it, and she'll have all the kids smell it, and she'll show everything that, you know, is inside that green pepper. Then she slices it up for the children, and they each take a bite of it, and you watch them, and it's the sweetest thing, but where they would have said no to their parents, they're experiencing, they're putting their mouth, this does taste yummy. Yeah. It's crunchy.
So we visited the Montessori School, Rochester, mm-hmm. and we got to see what the children experienced during their day. They're a perfect example of the use of natural elements in the classroom. Let's take a look.
I am currently working in the infant and toddler classroom. We will sit down and look at a fruit or a vegetable like a cucumber or a kiwi and let the children feel it and touch it and talk about, oh, is it smooth? Is it cold? Is it squishy? Is it, you know, and really feel it. We'll cut it open and we'll smell it and we'll have a piece that they can touch to see what it feels like, and we'll have a piece that they can taste so they can see what it tastes like.
Learning to be social and how to do that appropriately, learning to care about their world and their planet and their environment and their community. And they see their classroom as an authentic community. We don't solve their problems for them. We teach them how to solve problems themselves.
We do our work in one of two places. It's a table or a rug, unless it's at a defined space, like there's face washing, there's cloth washing, there's hand washing. That's at its own station, its own area, which is defined by the equipment. We model respect with the children, and then they in turn model respect. So it's just a very small but important visual cue of personal space. This is where I'm working, and you can respect it. This foundation that we're building here is a real gift. And so they're really, they hold hands and they engage, they joyfully work together. It's more of that team. Whatever their interest is, we try to feed, and we know how to kind of feed that interest with what they're doing socially, emotionally, and academically. So we'll maybe pair them up with a friend or a work or an activity that is engaging. So if you're doing something that you're interested in, time passes quickly and you're focused, you're joyful, you're learning, and that's really no stress.
Okay, so that is where my daughter Brighton goes, and she is three, almost four, and she loves it. So thank you very much.
Oh, you're welcome.
For providing a wonderful place for her to learn.
Thanks.
So let's talk a little bit more. One of the things that we've been really talking about is EMFs.
Yes.
We're hearing a lot more about it right now. Why don't you lead that on the topic?
So I think you and I were both at a seminar about a year ago, and there was a toxicologist there who was talking about the primary toxins in our environment these days, and everyone's saying, oh, it's got to be food, it's got to be air quality, and he said it's actually electromagnetic frequency. So it's fluorescent lights, it's Wi-Fi, it's Bluetooth, It's cell phones and iPads and computer screens and television screens. And he said they are primarily the greatest toxin in our environment these days. And it got me to thinking that, you know, when we were younger, we had none of that. Mm-hmm. And now children are, well, they're born to mothers who have been on cell phones their entire pregnancies, but they're born into a world where they're completely inundated by it. They can't get away from the electromagnetic frequencies. And what we do know from a lot of research is that it's changing brainwave patterns in kids, especially really in both genders, but we see a lot of that in boys at the age of 8. We see a real shift in their capacity and in their intellectual capabilities and their ability to sit and concentrate, and that's right when they're in school.
It's really interesting because at the school, many parents, when they come on tours, they'll ask, you know, what about computers? What about iPads? We don't use any of that. Children don't need it. They naturally know how to use this stuff, and we don't do that at the school. So they're not exposed to it in a Montessori, in most Montessori environments, right. In authentic Montessori environments. Even with things like lighting, fluorescent lighting, we were required when we custom built this school, we had to put in a certain number of fluorescent lights up on the ceilings for the children. We don't really use them. We turn them off and we use natural lighting, more lamps and things like that, because we want to reduce all of those toxins and keep it very, very natural and earthbound.
Well, thank you very much. So, I think right now we're going to go over to some questions from the audience. Okay. So,
hi, a lot of people now are using hand sanitizers. What do you think about children using hand sanitizers?
We just had this whole conversation about lotions and things you're putting on your skin. So, Dr. Heisel.
Let me start.
Yes, please.
Addressing hand sanitizers specifically, I'm really concerned with the fact that they strip all of the bacteria out of our bodies. So yes, they get rid of germs and dirt, but they also get rid of all of the good bacteria that we desperately need in order to both maintain our immune system and even for our neurological health. Again, it's preventing children from having a natural internal innate ability to defend against microbes, against toxins, and it's trying to provide something, but it's doing the exact counter. It's counterintuitive. My concern as well is that, again, we want to maintain as natural an environment as we can for our children. And one thing to bear in mind is that whatever we put on our skin ends up in our bloodstream, and it does so quite rapidly. And there are so many toxins in conventional products, even ones that you buy in the grocery store or the drugstore. If you can't read that list, if there are more chemical names than you can pronounce, you shouldn't be putting it on your kids' bodies. They're hormone modulators, they're disruptors, many of them are toxic and cancer-causing. And then we're all surprised when our kids aren't well, or when we're not well.
Well, one of the things that you've recommended is just direct coconut oil, like right on your skin, and it's amazing.
Yep. It can be full fat, it can be fractionated and more liquid, but absolutely. And if you look for things that have more natural ingredients, it's really easy to actually make products at home, but if you don't want to do that or you don't think that you have the time to do that, then at least be shopping at health food stores where you're not going to get a list of ingredients that you just can't pronounce.
Or ask your Montessori kid to make it, because we do things like that. We really do. It's amazing. We have an old-fashioned hand washing stand and an old-fashioned face washing where we teach them to go through all the steps. And before they can even get that soap, they're grating the soap. And they're making their own soaps. They might use natural oils, or they might use dried flowers and create their own mixtures. It's really amazing. It's so beautiful. But we do that all day long. You are not going to see your standard, you know, baby wipes. Let's wipe their face off. We do all of that. You know, we teach them the old-fashioned way to again reconnect.
Okay. And another question from our audience.
Coming up on cold and flu season, can you recommend a natural cough remedy?
Wonderful. Okay, there's a couple different. I mean, I know in our office we have a lot of Highland products. We find that they're amazing, and they have a wonderful cough remedy that people are dying for right now. But then I know we use a lot of doTERRA oils. So can you tell me a little bit about what you're recommending?
There are any number of essential oils that you can use that really help with decreasing inflammation in the respiratory system, with opening up the airway passages. Peppermint even is fantastic. Lemon and honey in hot water, you know, that old wives' tale is brilliant. Some lime essential oil and white fur on the chest that's diluted appropriately, amazing as well. And so there are a number of different products. Homeopathics, as you said, absolutely brilliant. There are a number of things that we can really do in order to not need to reach for the over-the-counter pharmaceuticals as a first resort, at least.
And as a mother, these are the things that we use. They taste better. The kids never fight for them. In fact, as I'm giving it to the child that's sick, the other one's saying, can we have some? And I get to say, yeah, because it's very natural. It's holistic. It's not going to harm them the way you wouldn't give over-the-counter cough medicine to the child that's not sick, because you don't want to do that. So.
Okay. And another question?
You just talked about cough and cold and all that. But in general, if you only had three items in your medicine cabinet, what would you pick as the most important?
Oh, for me?
Yeah, that would be hard.
Probiotics. First and foremost, probiotics. So something to increase the good, healthy flora, the good bacteria in the gut. That would be my first one.
As a mom, that's the main one for me, too. We always double up on it when they're sick.
Yeah. Well, we have an oil that we use. It's called En Garde, which is a protection blend. That's the number one thing that we have that I use every day for myself, my children. So that's my go-to. And then I'm a huge fan of chamomile to calm everybody down, arnica to help with muscle soreness and bruising. So it really depends on what we're looking for. Yeah. So
and this time of year, I'd really say vitamin D and vitamin C. You know, unfortunately, we don't live in Hawaii, any of us, which would be lovely. And so vitamin D to really maintain the immune system, vitamin C as well, can be extremely helpful to have.
Okay, wonderful. Well, I'd like to thank my guest, Joanne Shango and Dr. Marissa Heisel, for joining me today. It is our hope that we have brought we've been able to provide you with some information as well as some ideas. We don't have to make changes all at once. You want to analyze your lifestyle. You want to think of your budget. Consider the members of your family and how well they can handle change. Get them involved. Ask them what they think. Think big, but start small. Any change you make with your children right now in mind with a positive step towards better health and greater happiness. So thank you for joining us today on Living Well Naturally. I'm Dr. Anna Saylor, wishing you health and happiness.